I woke up. Simon was already up, and he made me birthday breakfast of Eggs Benedict. We both had to go to work, so we saved presents till later. I got to work, had some birthday cake. Children sang me happy birthday. Then I came home. The birthday meal was a takeaway, and Simon gave me his present, which I didn't mind. And after that, we talked about the baby. Turned into a big argument. Simon left. I was furious. I wanted to get as far away as I could and get some space to think. So I left. You have children? Yes, that's my birthday. Not one of the big ones, but I guess you can see that. It was my birthday, like you said. We were going to have a meal at home. We had our meal. He gave me his present. I guess I didn't like the present. Well, a week or so ago. It would have been the Saturday before my birthday. You know, I get like that on the weekends, have a lie-in, then want to get up and blitz the house. About 8 years back, it was a present to myself. I shouldn't even be drinking coffee with the baby. It's been hard trying to give it up. Black coffee, thanks. No sugar. Sweet enough as it is. Yes. I got to Glasgow. I was exhausted, so I pulled over and slept in the car. I woke up because a rubbish truck went past. I got some petrol, bought a coffee and a pastry, tried calling someone from a payphone, and then headed back. No. I've had enough coffee for today, thanks. Glass of water. Coffee, I guess. Milk and sugar. Mum and Dad had never had any reason to notice. They were always busy. If Hannah was eating a lot, they didn't mind. She didn't put on any weight. That girl has a healthy appetite. If they heard us talking in the attic, they just thought it was Hannah playing one of her games, and that Eve was our imaginary friend. Once, she was already up and dressed and ready to go to school, and I snuck down for a piss. Mum saw me in my underwear, she went mad. Get dressed this instant! So I ducked into our bedroom, and seconds later, out came Hannah, dressed and ready. Mum was amazed. Will you phone the house to let me know when you want to come round? Then I can make sure that I'm there. No, he doesn't keep a diary. That's my thing. I've kept one, well, as long as I can remember, since I was a girl. It helps make sense of my day. And when you're forced to put something into words, it just gives you perspective. Everyone's on the same page. When you've been married for 10 years, stuff accumulates. We could argue about anything. And he's so nice. That doesn't help. He tries to smooth things over, and that just makes it worse. We're both passive-aggressive, so we never normally argue directly about anything. There's no couple stuff, a stupid argument, nothing specific. No one knows how to push your buttons better than those you're close to. A long time. We got married when I was 17. Childhood sweethearts. Something like that. Are you married, detective? I did. Well, we met when we were 17, both working at the glaciers. No, I was 15, Carl was older, 17 I think. I was really into him, regardless of how he actually behaved. Lots of drunken teenage sex. We did it in a church once. It's stupid. So he got tired of us and we split up after about 6 months. It was sad, but those early experiences, they help you realise who's really important to you, you know? Family. Family. So, Carl fucked off. And then there were other boys here and there. And then Simon. Was he my first? No need to be so coy. No, he wasn't my first. That would have been Carl. He was a local boy in a band. He was a bit of a shit. but it was sexy. We were 15. Differences? She's a better driver than me. She passed the test for us. I tried to take it and nearly crashed the car. Learned that you can't rely on confidence to get you through everything. She is the shy one. She was especially shy around boys. If Hannah liked a boy, I would have to pursue him. It was that way with Carl. Hannah met him first. She had such a crush. I let him take my virginity after a night that his band had played at. It got difficult. When I was with Carl, we would have sex, but Hannah couldn't let him see she was a virgin. She had lots of excuses. After a while, we decided that I should take Hannah's virginity. It's not that different to a bruise, pulling a tooth, a graze. We used a hairbrush. After that, we took him in turns, though I was always the one who seduced the boys. Until Simon. Hannah was so smitten with Simon. She started getting jealous, didn't want to share. Even the first date. We went to see Tom Cruise at the Old Odeon. We both went, kept changing places in the toilet. We only had one best dress, so we had to keep swapping clothes. Must have thought we had terrible bladder problems. The next date, it was my turn. At the end, I let him kiss me. But that was it. We didn't want another Carl on our hands, and the Ouija board had said to hold back. After that, it was Hannah's turn, and she slept with him. Broke the rules. Deliberately broke the rules. She wanted to be the first to sleep with him. I mean, that's when she got pregnant. From that one time. It lasted about 6 months. I tried to carry on, but everything was different. Hannah insisted I not pretend to be her around Simon, let alone sleep with him. We didn't share him like the others. The rules had changed. Me living in the attic had become weird, in a way it hadn't been before. Parked up on the street. It was busy, so I parked down the end of the road. I walked up to the house. I knocked on the door. No answer. I took my keys out of my bag, unlocked the door. The main lock was unlocked. I could tell because the key wouldn't turn when I tried to turn it to the left. I walked in. Simon's coat wasn't on the peg. I couldn't see his shoes on the shoe rack. I shouted out for him. I walked straight into the kitchen. He usually sits in there to have a cup of tea and read his paper. He wasn't there. I touched the kettle, it was cold. I looked quickly into the living room, nothing. I walked upstairs to the bedroom, he wasn't there. I didn't search for him because it was pretty clear he wasn't there. Then I had a shower. Whilst I was in the shower, the phone rang. I think it was Eric, his boss. I didn't answer it. Then I came out and I was just exhausted. So I lay down on the bed and I fell asleep, but I didn't mean to. I woke up a couple of hours later and I was surprised to see no one in the bed next to me. And then I remembered where I was and what had happened. That's when Eric called again. I spoke to him. Then I called Simon's parents. And then I decided to come and see you. That enough? Just the kids.
became our way of life. We would swap places and take it in turns to do things, and we were very careful. Whoever had been out that day would come back and write a detailed diary so that we were on the same page. We had a list of rules that said what we could and couldn't do in any given situation. It was exhaustive. We lived a second life through those rules. Rules for things that could only ever happen inside our imaginations. We would consider all the permutations of future events and agree rules to walk our way through them. Okay, she's being chased. They're trying to catch her because she did something bad. I guess she broke the rules. Or maybe they think she did something bad. Maybe it wasn't her fault. She looks scared, not guilty. Maybe it was mistaken identity. Did they catch her then? I don't know. I don't see how it's hard. We've established I was in Glasgow when he was killed. We've spoken with the hospital. Ask the hospital. I got in the car and I drove. I just kept driving north. Just kept going, just wanted to get as far away as I could. When I finally stopped, I was all the way up in Glasgow. I was so tired. I just had to sleep. No, I don't think so. Glasgow was deserted that early in the morning. Thank you.